الله يباركه. ما شاء الله. الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله، الحمد لله حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وفقها في الدين يا رب العالمين. اللهم أعد الإسلام إلى دينك، أعد المسلمين إلى دينك ردا جميلا يا رب العالمين، وأعد بلاد فلسطين إلى ديار الإسلام حين يعز الإسلام ويمارس الإسلام بسلام ودون خوف يا رب العالمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We continue إن شاء الله on our study of Umar ibn al-Khattab. May Allah be pleased with him. And as I promised for those who were out of town on the weekend of Memorial Day, we will just go quickly over what we studied, inshallah, last time, and then we will continue with our subject today. As we know, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, may Allah be pleased with him, started the conquest, starting the Futuh of Asham, to spread Islam outside Arabia and to defend the invasion and the danger that was threatening Islam from outside the Arabian Peninsula. And those who were reverting into Islam of the non-Muslim, the one that were under the domain of the non-Muslim, two large empires at that time were punished, sometimes by death, like what happened to Farwa ibn Amr al-Juthami, who was killed on the days of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As we know, Abu Bakr sent four armies to Asham to fight the Byzantine, Amr ibn al-As, Shurahbil ibn Hasana, Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan, and Amin al-Ummah, Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. And he sent Khalid ibn al-Walid to al-Iraq to fight the Persians. And as we know, the Byzantines were very aware and alert of this incoming danger from Arabia, and they started getting and gathering huge armies in their one of their fortress in Syria called Homs, and in Dimashq as well. And they tried to get their armies closer to the Muslims, and they tried to get one Muslim army at a time. However, Amr ibn al-As, may Allah be pleased with him, had an idea to gather all the Muslim armies in Asham into one unit so they will be stronger. And they were gathered in Al-Yarmouk and in a valley of Al-Yarmouk in Jolan Heights. And Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah knew he was outnumbered 10 to 1, 30,000 Muslim fighters in front of 300,000 Byzantine fighters. So he sent to Umar ibn al-Khattab asking for help. And Umar ibn al-Khattab sends his sharpest arrow in his arsenal, Khalid ibn al-Walid, to help this army. And Khalid becomes the general commander of this particular army in the Battle of Al-Yarmouk, which was one of the most important battles that Muslim had in Asham, and one of the battle actually that set the stage for the conquest of Asham. And the Muslims were victorious in this army, and the Byzantines retreated into three major places, into Fihl in Al-Urdun, into Damascus, Dimashq, and to Homs. And then Umar ibn al-Khattab himself gives the directions into his new commander, Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, and he tells him that he needs to start with Dimashq, with Damascus. And we saw how Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah moved to Damascus with the bulk of the Muslim army. However, he sent a small army to Fihl to keep the rear of the Muslim army safe. And then he also attacked and besieged Damascus. And Damascus, with the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, became into the Muslim hands on the 14th year after Hijrah, in the year 636. Then the Muslims moved on to Fihl, which was one of the very important fortresses of the Byzantine and one of their army bases, so to speak. And the Muslims conquered Fihl as well. And then they moved on. Khalid and Abu Ubaidah went to Homs. Amr went to Palestine, as we will study inshallah today. And Shurahbil bin Hassana continued to secure the rest of the areas east of the Jordan River. Khalid and Abu Ubaidah continued on to Hims, and in Hims, a commander called Tozra tried to do a roundabout and tried to attack the Muslim army and tried to recapture Damascus. And Khalid ibn al-Walid was very aware, sent to Yazid. Yazid met the Tozra army from front. Khalid himself moved on with a small army from Abu Ubaidah's army, and the Tozra army was wiped out, and Hummus was besieged, and then alhamdulillah fallen into the Muslim command. After that, Khalid continued on north into Qunisrin, and then on to Aleppo, Halab, and then on to Arraha, which is now in northern Syria and southern Turkey. We continue, inshallah, today with the conquest and the futuh of Asham, and we will study what happened to Amr ibn al-As, that army that Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah sent to Asham, to Palestine. As we left last time, now these areas in that occupies most of Syria and Lebanon today is now in the Muslim hand, that is shaded in green. The cities of Damascus, Hims, Qunisrin, and Halab in the north, and everything in between. And the Iraq is now to the east. Now between Asham and Al-Iraq, there is an area that falls between the two rivers, between the Tigris and Euphrates, between Dajla and Al-Furat. And this area is very fertile, and it is known as Al-Jazeera, because Al-Jazeera in Arabic means the island, and that is basically any land that is surrounded with water. And as fertile and there is so much water in this area, it's called Al-Jazeera. Now Al-Jazeera was mostly, at that time, it is this area of Al-Jazeera would either fall under the Byzantine or under the Persian. Depends on who is more dominant in these wars. And on the days of this conquest of these futuh, Al-Jazeera was a Byzantine land. As we know, the last battle between the Byzantine and the Persian, which was on the days of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Byzantines were victorious. And the area of Al-Jazeera fell under the Byzantine. So Byzantine army still eastern of the new Muslim territory here in the Al-Jazeera. And that will come into importance later on, inshallah. Then Palestine. Palestine was very important to the Byzantine for its religious importance, for the city of Ilya, or what is known today as Al-Quds al-Sharif. May Allah return it to the Muslims, inshallah, or Jerusalem. And this area was governed by a man called Al-Artabun, or Artabun. He was the shrewdest, most intelligent general that Heraclius had at that time. And he gave him the commander, he made him the general commander of Philistine. Amr ibn al-As was also one of the shrewdest, most intelligent commanders that the Muslim army had. And when Umar ibn al-Khattab was told, well, we have a problem in Philistine because there is this Artabun, there is this intelligent. And he said this famous word about Amr ibn al-As. He said, "Ramayna Artabun al-Rumi bi Artabun al-Arab." He said, "We have thrown to the Artabun of al-Rum with our Artabun of al-Arab, who is Amr ibn al-As." He said, "We have his match. We have his equal in shrewdness and intelligence in war." Amr ibn al-As moved from Damascus on the commands of his general commander, Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, and he moved to an area south of Jerusalem called Ajnadin. Ajnadin was very important to the Romans. It was the southern gate of Philistine. And whoever controls Ajnadin will have a straight path to Al-Quds. Whoever controls Al-Lid, as brother Abu Hassan corrected me, it's Al-Lid or Ar-Ramla at that time, will control the northern gates for Jerusalem. So Amr ibn al-As decided to move on to the south and start the battle from Ajnadin. In Ajnadin, Artabun had to move his forces to protect that southern fortress. And he moved a lot of forces. This is zooming in, and this is still the 15th year of Hijrah. And Al-Artabun moved on to Ajnadin with a huge army, and he secured two protectorate army in both Al-Qudus and Al-Ramla, or Al-Lid. And the two cities of Al-Lid and Al-Ramla are very close to each other. Between Al-Ramla and Jerusalem, they're only 18 miles. And the Palestinian brothers can correct me if this is wrong. No, this is Ramla. This is Ramla, which is very close to Al-Lid. And between that and Jerusalem, there's about 18 miles. So, in 15 years after Hijrah, the Muslim army had to face the Byzantine army in Ajnadin. Amr ibn al-As was, as we know, very shrewd and very intelligent. He has to fight a huge battle in Ajnadin while there is two armies that can attack him, while he's busy fighting the protecting army of Ajnadin. So he did a very important thing against this Artabun. He took two brigades out of his army, and he sent one to Jerusalem, and he sent one to Ar-Ramla. And on those two armies was Muhammad ibn Amr and Amarat ibn Amr ibn Umayyah al-Dhumri. So he said, you keep them busy. I don't want you to go into the cities because the armies are too small. They can be wiped out easily. He said, you just go into some type of commando operations, into skirmishes with these armies, and keep them busy and keep our northern front safe. So no move can hit Amr from the back while he is in a very important and a very big battle with this Artabun. And Amr faced the Artabun in Ajnadin, and with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's grace, Amr ibn al-As and his army, his Muslim brothers, were able to take Ajnadin, and al-Artabun fled into Jerusalem with a very large part of his army. And the orders to Muhammad bin Amr was, if he saw this army retreating, to let them go. Do not face them and withdraw to Ajnadin. So if the orders was, if you see the Byzantine fleeing from Ajnadin, do not try to intercept, move about and come back to Ajnadin, because Amr ibn al-As wanted to keep Ajnadin in as his southern base. And what happened in Ar-Ramla, it fell actually with under Amr al-Jumhi, Amr ibn Umayyah al-Jumhi, and he was able to control Ar-Ramla. So what is left there is a very huge army inside Jerusalem, inside Al-Qudus. At that time, Abu Ubaidah, Khalid, Shurahbil, and Yazid, all of them finished their missions. And Abu Ubaidah gave the commands that all the armies should come to Jerusalem, the last very important city in southern Ash-Sham. And what happened is Amr ibn al-As moved on to Jerusalem, and he there met with the rest of the Muslim armies of Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, Khalid ibn al-Walid, Shurahbil ibn Hasana, and Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan. We see this tactic over and over again. When the Muslims have a big battle, like the Battle of Dimashq, or the Battle of Al-Qudus, of Ilia, of Jerusalem, they will gather all their smaller armies together and get ready for the big battle. At-Tabari said about Ajnadin is, نزل أرطبون العرب أرطبون الروم في أجنادين حتى كثر القتلى بينهم فهزمه وارتد أرطبون العرب إلى أسوار القدس. And he said, Al-Tabari, that the fighting in Ajnadin was as fierce as the fighting of Al-Yarmouk. So Ajnadin was not a small battle, it's one of the major battles of Asham. And if you go into even the non-Muslim history books, you will see Ajnadin as one of the landmark battles in Futuh Asham. Actually, the number was not reported, and that's why I did not say it. However, it was said in a Tabari that it was a very large army, and the Muslim army, as we know, is about 40,000 in general. However, the 40,000 were spread, and they did not regroup again until Jerusalem. And Ajnadin, there is no mention of how long the battle is, and inshallah we'll try to look it up if I missed it. Yes?
After these victories in Asham and all, like,
very little. The question is, how many of the local people joined the Muslim army in their battle? At this early stage of the Futuh, there were very few. It was mostly the Sahaba and the Tabi'een and the armies that went up from the Arabian Peninsula at that time. Around Jerusalem, the siege started. What is known as Hisaru Ilya, or the siege of Ilya. And we know Ilya is the name of Al-Qudus at that time. And that was in the 15th year of Hijrah. Now, in some references, you will see that it is in the 17th year of Hijrah. And most references will go into this was the 15th year, that is what goes on about 637 ADCE. But most historians think it was the 15th year of Hijrah. Some of them think it was actually the 17th year after the Hijrah of the Prophet ﷺ. The Muslim camped around Jerusalem, which has very high walls and very well fortified city. And the third day of the siege, the fighting started around Jerusalem. And the way it started is the Muslims started getting closer to the walls, and they were showered with arrows from high above into their camps and into their forward army. And they had to retreat back, and that continued back and forth. And the siege of Jerusalem, according to most scholars, lasted for 4 months. 4 months, and the Muslims around the walls of Jerusalem. The first, Amr ibn al-As started the battle alone on the third day. On the 11th day, he was joined by Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, Khalid ibn al-Walid, Shuahbil ibn Hassanah, and the Muslim army started gathering around Jerusalem. But yet, even with the gathering around Jerusalem, Jerusalem was a very well fortified city. And defending the city, the Byzantine, they knew they had nothing to lose, and they continued their fighting. And again, the winter came. There was snow, there were hail, and there were rain around Jerusalem, that is reported by historian, and the Muslims withstood their positions, and they did not lift the siege of Jerusalem. Artabun was inside Jerusalem, and he wrote to Amr ibn al-As. He said, إِنَّكَ نَظِيرِي, you are my equal. وَمْنَأَنْتَ فِي قَوْمِكَ مِثْلِي فِي قَوْمِي, and you among your people is like me in my people. He's saying that let's you and I have some type of intelligent conversation. We are each other's equal. He said, وَاللَّهِ لَا تَفْتَحُ مِنْ فِلَسْطِينَ شَيْئًا بَعْدَ أَجْنَادِينَ. He said, after you won in Ajnadin, you will get nothing else in Philistine. You cannot get Ilya. You cannot get Jerusalem. That's what the Artabun is telling Amr ibn al-As. فَرَجِعْ وَلَا تُغْرِهْ فَتَلْقَى مَا لَقِيَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ الْهَزِينَ. He said, do not be arrogant. Do not let that victory of Ajnadin make you so boastful and proud and make you think you're going to win. You will find defeat. So go back and spare your armies the shame of defeat. So Amr writes him back. And he said, أَنَا صَاحِبُ فَتْحِ هَذَا الْبِلَادِ. He said, I am the conqueror. I am the fatih of this land. That is it. I'm not leaving until you are defeated. He's telling him that don't try to scare me out. And Artabun gets the letter and he said, no. And this is according to At-Tabari. He said, you are not the conqueror of this land. The conqueror of this land, in our scholars, is a man named Umar and not Amr. He said, don't claim that you will be the conqueror of Jerusalem, because the conqueror of Jerusalem, his name is Umar and not Amr. So Amr ibn al-As think about this, and he sends to Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him. He said, these people think that you are the one to conquer this place by yourself. In a different, in Ibn al-Athir, that Sophronius was the patriarch of Jerusalem, the great patriarch of Jerusalem. And Sophronius went and contacted Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. And you see, in history, there's sometimes more than one narration of a story. So I'm just reporting the different reports in history about the conquest of Jerusalem, about Fatah Palestine. And he said that if you let Umar ibn al-Khattab come to Jerusalem, then we will surrender Jerusalem to him peacefully. Now, they also are tired. They know that besieged in the most difficult situation, and the Muslim army is relentless. So they wanted to surrender the city, but they wanted to surrender the city to none but Umar ibn al-Khattab. And Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, comes from al-Madinah himself after Sophronius asked for him, and he comes to Jerusalem to have the peaceful surrender of Jerusalem after the futile, fruitless siege of the city that lasted about 4 months. One of the stories that are reported in history that Umar ibn al-Khattab was with his servant, Aslam, and he had a donkey that he's traveling on. He did not have a fancy ride. And he approached Jerusalem, and him and his servant were alternating shifts, who rides and who walks. And as they got close to the city, and it was winter time, then Umar ibn al-Khattab said to his servant, it's your turn to get on the donkey. And Aslam said, well, ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, you are going into the city victorious as a conqueror. It is better that you would be the one who's riding, and I would walk. He said, no, Umar ibn Khattab knows nothing but justice and fairness. And he said to his servant, no, it is your turn. You get on that donkey. And he was leading his servant who was riding on that donkey. And because it was winter time, it was muddy, the area, and his feet was just filled with mud, and he wore his usual clothes that had different patches on it. And as Sophronius was walking out to receive Umar ibn al-Khattab, his bishops told him, here's Umar, he's on the donkey. And Sophronius said, no, he is not on the donkey, he is the man in the mud with 40 patches and on his garment, and that's his description in our books. Is he would walk into Jerusalem leading his servant on a donkey with 40 different patches in his own garments. And that's the one that would conquer Jerusalem. And that's just one of the story that was reported. Most important than that is the treaty between Umar ibn al-Khattab and the people of Jerusalem, the Christian of Jerusalem. Now, just to give you an idea about what was going on at that time, Jerusalem was governed by the Byzantine. The Byzantines were suppressing two different groups of people, two different religion. The first was the real old Christianity of the Unitarian or the Jacobian or Ali Aqiba, who did not share the same Trinity views of the Catholic Byzantine, Eastern Byzantine Church. The other group that the Byzantine wanted to keep out completely of Jerusalem were the Jews. The Jews were not allowed into Jerusalem at that time. And it was very important for the Christians, a protection of Jerusalem, to not allow Jews in. And the treaty goes as follows. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. هذا ما أعطى عبد الله عمر. This is what Abdullah Umar gave أمير المؤمنين gave أهل إيليا من الأمان. The vows and the treaty and the promises that he is giving the people of Eliya. أعطاهم أمانا لأنفسهم وأموالهم. They are safe upon their own selves and their money, their belongings. That the Muslims will go into the city, they will not kill anybody, and they will not take anybody's belonging or money. ولكنائسهم, and for their churches will not be taken away from them. ولصلبانهم, and their crosses will not be broken. وسقيمها وبريئها وسائر ملتها. He said, everybody is safe, including the healthy and the sick. من أنه لا تسكن كنائسهم ولا تهدم. That we will not take their churches and their cathedrals as a place of dwelling, or will not ruin their churches and cathedrals. ولا ينتقص منها ولا من حيزها ولا من صليبهم. And not even any part of their churches will be taken from them. We will not take any parts of their temples, churches, and cathedrals. We will know the people. Why is that important? That's what Sophronius wanted and Umar agreed to, because when they went into Damascus, the deal was you take half of everything. So they took half of the cathedrals and converted it into mosque, like what happened with the great mosque of Damascus. وَلَا يُكْرَهُونَ عَلَى دِينِهِمْ. And there will not be, there will be no compulsion in the religion. Nobody, none of them will be forced to change their religion. وَلَا يُضَارَّ أَحَدًا مِّنْهُمْ. And none of them will be harmed. وَلَا يَسْكُنُ بِإِلْيَاءَ مَعَهُمْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْيَهُودِ. And he said, we will not let the Jews come and inhabit إِلْيَاء Jerusalem with you. And that many people will try to take as discrimination of Umar ibn al-Khattab against the Jews. But if people want to study the historical facts, the Christians always thought that the Jews are the allies of the Muslims, because the Muslims have all these treaties with the Jews. And they will let the Jews into Jerusalem, because Jerusalem is very important for the Jews. And now since the Muslims are coming, then they will let the Jews come in. But Sophronius wanted to make sure that part of the treaty would be that Jerusalem would stay with the Christians, and none of the Jews will be allowed in by the Muslim. So it was actually the Christians that were afraid that the Muslims will bring the Jews in. So as today's politics may play a role into trying to understand this particular clause, it is the Muslims that were actually protecting the Jews in Asham, and the Christians and the Byzantines were slaughtering the Jews at that time. And he said, وَعَلَىٰ أَهْلِ إِلْيَا. This is what the Muslims will guarantee for the people of Jerusalem. Now here is what the people of Jerusalem will guarantee the Muslims. وَعَلَىٰ أَهْلِ إِلْيَا أَنْ يُعْطُوا الْجِزْيَةَ كَمَا يُعْطِي أَهْلُ الْمَدَائِنِ. He said they will have to pay the jizya tax like the rest of the people, like exactly equal to the rest of the new cities freed by the Muslims. وَعَلَيْهِمْ أَنْ يُخْرِجُوا مِنْهَا الرُّومَ وَالنُّصُوصِ. And they have to expel the Byzantine and the army, the Byzantine people, the non-Jerusalem inhabitants. They have to be expelled, they have to leave. And the robbers, the criminals, they have to leave Jerusalem. فَمَنْ خَرَجَ مِنْهُمْ. Those who leave, فَإِنَّهُ آمِنٌ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِهِ وَمَالِهِ حَتَّى يَبْلُغُوا مَأْمَنَهُمْ. Those who leave peacefully, they are safe with themselves and their money until they reach their destination. I mean, this is how more fair can you get than that? Subhanallah. وَمَنْ أَقَامَ مِنْهُمْ فَهُوَ آمِنٌ وَعَلَيْهِ مِثْلُ مَا عَلَىٰ إِلْيَاءَ مِنَ الْجِزْيَةِ. He said, those who do not want to leave, like the Byzantines that want to stay. The Byzantines are not from Jerusalem. The Byzantines are from Rome, from the Eastern Byzantine Empire. But those who want to live in Jerusalem, he said they can, but they have to pay the jizya tax, and they also will be safe. So there was not, it was not ethnic cleansing. It was not leaving. If those who wants to stay, they can stay based on the treaty, and they do not want to stay, they can leave safely until they get to their destination. Then, more than that, وَمَنْ أَحَبَّ مِنْ أَهْلِ إِلْيَاءَ أَنْ يَسِيرَ بِنَفْسِهِ وَمَالِهِ مَعَ الرُّومِ وَيُخَلِّي بِيَعَهُمْ وَصُلُبَهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ آمِنُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Those people of Jerusalem that want to leave with the Roman, they also can leave with the Roman. So everybody has a choice to either stay or leave, whether they are people of Ilia, of Jerusalem, or if they are Byzantine. I mean, this is a treaty that gives so much guaranteed rights to those who were under the siege. And he said, وَمَنْ شَاءَ رَجْعَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ فَإِنَّهُ لَا يُؤْخَذُ مِنْهُمْ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى يُحْصَدَ حَصَادُهُمْ. He said, we will not start taking the tax until the harvest time. He said, because what people have is what they are saving during that season. So if the Muslims start taking the tax from them, they'll make them poor, or they may have some hunger or starvation. He said, none of the tax will be collected, none of the jizya will be collected until harvest time, until you actually have enough. SubhanAllah, this is how much generosity the Muslims had in their conquest. وَعَلَى مَا فِي هَذَا الْكِتَابِ عَهْدُ اللَّهِ وَذِمَّةُ رَسُولِهِ وَذِمَّةُ الْخُلَفَاءِ وَذِمَّةُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. He said, I give you my vows. The secured by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and secured by His Prophet, and secured by the khulafa, by the successors of the Prophet, and secured by the promise and the vow of the rest of mu'min. إِذَا أَعْطَوِ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ الْجِزْيَةِ. As long as you pay your own jizya, then this treaty is ongoing and it will be valid. وَشَهِدَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. And the witnesses upon this, خَالِدُ بْنُ الْوَلِيدِ وَعَمْرُ بْنُ الْعَاصِ وَعَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ بْنِ عَوْفِ وَمُعَاوِيَةَ بْنِ أَبِي سُفْيَانِ. The witnesses were Khalid, Amr, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, and Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. وَكَتَبَ وَحَضَرَ سَنَةَ 15. And in this particular text from Al-Tabari, the conquest of Jerusalem was on the 15th year of Hijrah, as according to most accounts. SubhanAllah, yes. And this is the most peaceful conquest of Jerusalem that is known in history. And Jerusalem became a Muslim city, and inshallah remains a Muslim city to the day of judgment and returns to the Muslims. Ameen. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Amr ibn al-Khattab went into Jerusalem and walked in, and first thing that the Muslim Fatih, the conqueror, will do is to first establish the Salah. And he wanted to establish a Salah in the place that is most sacred and most known for Muslims, and the one that is mentioned in the Quran. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the beginning of Surah Al-Isra, praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Asra made the journey of Isra with his servant Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the Mosque Al-Haram to the Masjid Al-Aqsa, from Masjid Al-Haram to Masjid Al-Aqsa. And at that time it was bishara, it was a glad tiding, it was a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah will give the Muslims this place. It was not a masjid at that time, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called it the masjid. And we know that that's the place that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed and made salah on the night of Al-Mi'raj with the rest of the prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first thing Umar ibn al-Khattab wanted to do is to walk and find the place of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and Iqamat al-Salah, to make the salah. At that time, and I put this picture because most people, when they hear of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, they have their image, this particular image of this golden dome and this particular masjid in their mind. But this is not the Masjid Al-Aqsa. This is Masjid Al-Sakhra. This is the Mosque of the Rock. And I will, inshallah, go over that. As Umar ibn al-Khattab was led to this place, he wanted to know where Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa was. Now, Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa is in the area called Al-Haram Al-Sharif. Now, if you see, this is Jerusalem, the blessed city, the sacred city, and this is the sacred sanctuary. This entire place is the Haram Al-Sharif. The entire place is the Haram Al-Sharif. And this particular place where we have this golden dome is where As-Sakhra was, the rock. So what's the story of this rock? This rock was sacred. This is a sacred rock mostly to the Jews. And this is the Qibla. The Qibla of the Jews. And they, this is where Ya'qub, may Allah alayhi salam, according to their own revelation and religion and beliefs, where Ya'qub spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was the most sacred spot for them at that time. And the Romans, the Byzantine, as they were the enemies of the Jews, they made this place a dumpster. So they would throw the garbage and the dead animals, and they make this place as filthy and as humiliated as possible to humiliate the Jews, as where the Jews will pray or move into their Qibla. That's what they will be forwarding. That's what they will be facing, facing the garbage. So Umar ibn al-Khattab came to this place and he saw all of this garbage and dirt and all of that. And he started cleaning, and everybody started cleaning with him. And he respected the place as much as any Muslim and believer would. And he cleaned that area of As-Sakhra. And then he wanted, after cleaning the place, he wanted to make the Salah. With him was Ka'b. And Ka'b, Ka'b al-Ahbar, as he was known, Ka'b of he was known as Ka'b the, of the rabbis, because he was a Jewish rabbi, and then he became a Muslim. And we know the story of Ka'b. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to Medina, Ka'b went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, "You are the one that we know his description, like we know our own children. And I bear witness that there is no God but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are Muhammad, his prophet." He said, "Tell the Jews, you are a rabbi, you are a scholar." He said, "No, I will show you what the rest of the rabbis will do." He said, "Hide me and bring him in and ask him about me." So Ka'b hid where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, and the rabbis came and he said, "Ma taquluna fi Ka'b? What do you say about Ka'b?" Yes, they said, "Sharifuna wa ibn sharifina wa sayyiduna wa hibruna." He said, "He is the honor of the honorable, the elite of the elite, and the scholar of the scholars. We have nobody better than Ka'b." And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ukhruj alayhim ya Ka'b." Come up, Ka'b. And Ka'b went out and he said, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka ya Muhammadun Rasulullah." So the Jews, the rabbis that were there, they said, "Wadi'una wa wadnu wadi'ina wa safihuna wa ibn safihina." He said, "He is the lowest of the low. He is the most ignorant of the ignorance." So immediately changed their view. This is Ka'b, who came with Umar ibn al-Khattab to this place, who he knew well from the studies of the Jewish religion that he was on. And Umar said, "Where do we pray? Where do we make salah?" And Ka'b said, "Pray behind the rock." So you made, this is south, by the way. So he said, "You pray behind the rock and you will face the Ka'ba." And Ka'b wanted to have some respect for the rock, as the rock will be in front of the Musalla. And then Umar ibn al-Khattab said, "Yabna al-Yahudiyyati khalatta al-Yahudiyya." "You son of the Jewish, you are coming, get me closer to the Jewish religion." "Bal amamaha." He said, "No, in front of it." "Usalli haythu salla Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." He said, "I will pray where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed." "Fa inna lana sudur al masajid." He said, "For the Muslims is the front of the masjid." It's not, we're not gonna make the Qibla in the middle or the mihrab in the middle. We have the front of the middle. And this is what is called as Musalla Umar, the place of Salat Umar, or what is today known as Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, the Mosque Al-Aqsa. May Allah return it safely and to the Muslims' hand. Ameen, inshaAllah. So Umar ibn al-Khattab takes the dirt and cleaned the area, and he made the Iqamat al-Salah in Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. Yes. Jazakallah khair. The other importance for the Muslim is, some scholars say that's where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started the ascent to heavens. This is where the Mi'raj. The Mi'raj means the ladder. in Arabic, if you go to the root of the word, means the ladder. It's the place of ascension. And that's where the most scholars say then from that place, after the Prophet finished prayer in al-Masjid, he went on and he started his ascension to heaven from this particular rock. So this rock only is not only important for the Jewish religion, it's very important for the Muslims for that particular reason as well. As the Masjid al-Aqsa, as a sacred area as well. Yes, subhanAllah, this is one of the most important masajid that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put to mankind. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that, only knows how ancient and how old this has been a sacred and place for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Islam is none but a continuation of the same message and the same revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just before I take more questions, just, Umar ibn al-Khattab moved on and went to the churches with Sophronius to visit some of the churches of the Christians and of the area. And the Salah came while he was in the church that is very well respected by the Christians, known as Kaniset al-Qiyamah. And the Salah time came, and Umar was invited to make Salah in the church. And Umar said, "No, I will do it outside the church." As he just signed this treaty saying that we will not take any parts of your church for me and the people behind me. He said, the Muslims after me will come and they will say, Huna salla Umar. Here where Umar prayed, here where Umar qayyid salah, and they will take that from you. They will take part of this church and will convert it into a masjid. So he went outside the church and he made salah there. And today stands a masjid in Al-Qudus al-Sharif known as Masjid Umar, where Umar ibn al-Khattab رضي الله عنه made his salah outside Jerusalem. Yes, Fawzi. This is a very weak story that the rock tried to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We know the miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are not sensible miracles. The miracle is what we read, inshallah, every day. Is the Quran Kareem, is this revelation, this religion that continued to be what it is for the last 1,424 years from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the followers following the same teaching of the without deviation, without changing from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the miracle of Islam. Wallahu a'lam. Allah knows best. Yes.
Christians also believe
that happened in Mecca.
Is the Wailing Wall?
Jerusalem, correct me. Wailing Wall is right there, right? It's right there, western. Yes, it's called by the way, this has been known for long as the wall of Al-Buraq, the ride of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Jews call it the Wailing Wall.
What is the Church of Nativity?
That's the Church of Nativity is what we're talking about. When Umar was visiting and he walked outside and he made his salah, and it's still a Christian place till today.
Was it place of worship?
Allah knows best. Nobody knows. Allah knows best. So inshallah we continue on. Now, Jerusalem, after Jerusalem became the Muslim city, the entire areas of Palestine, Jordan, Lebanon today, and most of Syria became under the Muslim rule. And subhanAllah, that was around the 17th maximum. Most scholars agree that that was at the 17th year of Hijrah, 639 AD, Common Era. Now, the Al Jazeera stayed. And as we said, that would be an important issue later on, is the area of Al Jazeera. There is a city that stands today called Raqqa in Syria. And that was one of the places that the Byzantine gathered their army. And as the Muslim army is busy in the south, most Muslim armies in the south, that was their golden opportunity to attack and counterattack into Asham. And what they did is they went into Hims. Abu Ubaid ibn Jarrah was in Hims at that time as he was trying to lead operations in Asham. And he saw this huge Byzantine army coming from Raqqa into Hims to occupy, to take Hums again. And he did not know what to do. If he stayed in there, that he would sacrifice all the small army that was with him, as most the bulk of the Muslim army was in the south. And Abu Ubaidah was in Hims. And we know the Muslim army did not increase. It's the same 40 to 45,000 people that were in that area. But now it's a huge area that they have to spread and protect. So by just simple math, the army in every single new city is actually smaller than the army that went into Asham. So protect each and single city became a more difficult issue in this stage of Al-Fatih. So what did he want to do? Abu Ubaidah decided to withdraw from Hims. Decided to leave Hims and go to Damascus. Hims is well fortified, but not as well fortified as Damascus, as we studied last session. And in Damascus, there is Yazid, and there is more Muslim armies in Damascus, which is easier to defend and easier to regroup. So here's what Abu Ubaidah wanted to do. Mu'adh, he consulted with his companions, and Mu'adh ibn Jabal was with him in Hims, and Mu'adh said, do not withdraw. Do not leave a place that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us victory in and gave us conquest in, gave us fatah. And he said, do not do that because coming back into that city will be much harder than the first conquest of the city. Abu Ubaidah said, Sadaqa wallahi wa bar. He said, yes. And he tried to hold on in Hims. However, the armies continued to grow more and continued to become a real danger that would wipe out the people in Hims and the Muslim army in Hims. And Abu Ubaidah wanted to do a tactical withdrawal from Hims to Damascus. So what does he do? Listen to this Muslim generosity, Muslim honesty of war, unparalleled in history. When they went to Hims, they took from Hims what they had with the treaty. They said they will take the same deal with Damascus, if we remember. So half of the wealth of Hims went to Muslims. Abu Ubaidah told the army, every single person return everything back to the people of Hims. This is the loot that they took, the spoils of war. They said, why should we return it back to them? We were victorious. We took this by our war. And he said, Abu Ubaidah, he said, لا ينبغي لنا إن لم نمنعهم أن نأخذ منهم شيئا. He said, this jizya that we take it from them is to protect them. And now we cannot protect them. We're withdrawing. So we give it back to them. We give the jizya back. We give whatever we take back to the people of Hims and we withdraw. And then he looked at the people of Hims that were Christians at that time. And he said, نحن على ما كنا عليه. We keep the same treaty between us and you. لا نرجع فيه إلا أن ترجعوا فيه. He said, if we come back, we will give you the same deal. That's what he's telling them. وَإِنَّمَا رَدَدْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ أَمْوَالَكُمْ. But we are giving you your money back because we hate. لِأَنَّا كَرِهْنَا أَن نَأْخُذَ أَمْوَالَكُمْ وَلَا نَمْنَعَ بِلَادَكُمْ. We don't want to take your money and not protect your country, your city. So here is the Muslim, it's just to give the freedom and protection to the people that of these cities. And he said, وَلَكِنَّنَا نَتَنَحَّى إِلَى بَعْضِ الْأَرَاضِي وَنَبْعَثُ إِلَىٰ إِخْوَانِنَا فَيُقْدِمُوا عَلَيْنَا. He said, I will withdraw to a different land, meaning Damascus. And then I will ask my brothers to come to me for help. ثُمَّ نَلْقَى عَدُوَنَا. Then I will come back and I will face our enemy. And فَإِنْ أَظْفَرَنَا اللَّهُ بِهِمْ. So if we are victorious again, وَفَيْنَا لَكُمْ بِعَهْدِكُمْ. We will give you that treaty and we will give you that protection back. إِلَّا أَلَّا تَطْلُبُ ذَلِكَ. Unless you don't want it. Unless you don't want our protections. Because we couldn't protect you once, then you have the right to refuse our protection again. See that? He said, we offered our protection, you accepted it, and you paid for it, and we let you down. So if we come back again and you don't want it, then you are free to refuse that. This is how generous this conqueror and this Muslim is. And he left people from Hims to Dimashq, and the people of Hims, as narrated in Tariq al-Tabari, they started saying, رَدَّكُمُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْنَا. May Allah send you back. The Muslims, they don't want the Christian army. They're Christians. They don't want the Byzantines to come in. He said, رَدَّكُمُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْنَا وَلَعَنَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ يَكَانُوا يَمْلِكُونَنَا مِنَ الرُّومِ. Those who will govern us from the room, may Allah curse them. وَلَكِنْ وَاللَّهِ لَوْ كَانُوا هُمَّا رَدُّوا عَلَيْنَا وَلَكِنْ غَصَبُونَا وَأَخَذُوا مَا قَدِرُوا عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَمْوَالِنَا. He said, the Byzantine robbed us, took as much as they can before they left. He said, here you are returning the money back to us. When the Byzantine left, they took as much as they could take with them. And here you are leaving with what you came in with. لَوِلَايَتُكُمْ وَعَدْلُكُمْ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْنَا مِمَّا كُنَّا إِلَيْهِ مِمَّا كُنَّا فِيهِ مِنَ الظُّلْمِ وَالْغُشْمِ. He said, your justice and your government is much more beloved, much better to us than the misguidance and the transgression that we were in. And that's why you see the reversion back into Islam was very easy for these people that saw how the Muslims treated them in hardship and in prosperity, and how the Byzantines were treating them. And then Abu Ubaidah went to Asham, and he settled in Asham in Dimashq, and he sent to Umar ibn al-Khattab. He said, here's what happened, we lost Homs, and I want help. And the letters actually are reported, but just for the sake of time, I will not read the whole thing. The bottom line, he said, حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ وَبِاللَّهِ نَسْتَعِينُ. And here's what happened, and I will ask your advice and your help, Ya Umar. So Umar ibn Khattab tries now here with, he draws the most ingenious way. Now Asham is now opened again. Homs is the middle of Asham. Dimashq is next, and most of Asham can be attacked from everywhere. And the northern areas of Qannisrin and Taqiya and Halab, they all can fall prey to the forwarding and the progressing Byzantine army. And people will start getting scared. So Umar ibn Khattab wanted to handle this situation in the most ingenious way. He let them fortify in Damascus. He has an army fighting the Persian in Al-Iraq. Now the first time the Muslims were in trouble, see, this is the general commander that doesn't only see the one front. He is handling this entire operation, this entire war. And he knows that one of his best commanders is fighting in Al-Iraq, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, one of the 10 that are given the glad tidings of Al-Jannah. So Umar sends to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, and he said, here's what happened. Send your armies, instead of going east, I need you to send them west. I want you to send an army to Homs, an army to Al-Raqqa, and an army to Al-Jazeera. He wanted to fight the Byzantine from their back, from their behind. He said, he sent Al-Qa'qa ibn Amr to Homs. He sent Suhail ibn Adi to Al-Raqqa, and he put the general command in Iyad ibn Ghanam. Iyad ibn Ghanam, who sent him to Al-Jazeera. Now the forwarding army of the Byzantine has many people of Al-Jazeera from the tribes that are allied with the Byzantine, Rabi'a and Tanukh. A lot of the fighters of that army were from these two tribes that are settled in Al-Jazeera, Arabic tribes that has been allied with the Byzantine, Rabi'a and Tanukh, they're Christian tribes. So what happened, Umar himself led an army from Medina to Asham, come for another visit to Asham to rescue Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah and the rest of the Muslim army. And upon the news that here's what's going on, the Muslims are pushing from every direction into these areas, the people of Rabi'a and Tanukh left. And they went to Al-Jazeera to protect their own tribes against the army of Iyad ibn Ghanam. So that weakened the armies of the Byzantine in the two cities of Al-Raqqa and in Homs. And the Muslims attacked in Al-Jazeera, in Al-Raqqa and in Homs. And Umar ibn al-Khattab did not see battle actually in Syria, because the victory became to Muslims before Umar ibn al-Khattab and his army and Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah have to go up north and fight. However, he went and he reached only to Al-Jolanhaid, the Golan Heights. And he reached the area of Al-Jabiya, and he gave a speech to the Muslim armies. And he said, in that very famous speech, which is a long speech, but in the most important section he said to people, and he was facing people that are not companions, that are not sahaba, that most of them are tabi'een, that have not seen the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was giving them the final recommendations of Umar ibn Khattab, and he said, أَحْسِنُوا إِلَىٰ أَصْحَابِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يُلُونَهُمْ. He said, be good to my companions, and then the ones after them. ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. Then the ones after them, and then said, after that, as the prophecy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, ثُمَّ يَجِئُ قَوْمٌ يَحْلِفُ أَحَدُهُمْ عَلَى الْيَمِينِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يُسْتَحْلَفَ عَلَيْهَا. He said, then after them, there will come people that will start giving their oath and their swear before somebody even asked them to. وَيَشْهَدُ عَلَى الشَّهَادَةِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يُسْتَشْهَدُ. They will give their testimony before they're asked to. They become witnesses. And he said, فَمَنْ أَحَبَّ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يَنَالَ بُحْبُوحَةَ الْجَنَّةِ فَلْيَلْزَمِ الْجَمَاعَةِ. He said, those who want to come to the vast wideness of paradise, let them stay with the jama'ah. Let them stay with the bulk of Muslims. And none on that was, this recommendation was so important later on the days of fitna, when Ali ibn Abi Talib and Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan had their conflicts. فَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ مَعَ الْوَاحِدِ وَهُوَ مِنَ الْإِثْنَيْنِ أَبْعَدِ. He said, the shaitan tried to target the single person. And when they're two together, then the shaitan will stay away farther. So stay together with each other. And then he said, وَلَا يَخْلُوَنَّ رَجُلٌ بِمْرَأَةٍ فَإِنَّ ثَالِثَهُمَ الشَّيْطَانِ. Do not let a man and a woman be alone, because the third one will be the shaitan and the temptation of shaitan. And he said, وَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ تَسُرُّهُ حَسَنَتُهُ وَتَسُوءُهُ سَيِّئَتُهُ فَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. And thus he said, who are happy with their good deeds, and they get sad when they do bad deeds, then they are mu'min, then they are the true believers. And then he met with Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, and he asked him, he said, take us to your house, Abu Ubaidah. Abu Ubaidah said, what do you want to do in my house? You're gonna just weep in my house? He said, you want to cry in my house? He said, let me go into your house. And he went into the house of Abu Ubaidah, the governor of this entire territory. The wealth of Asham fell into the lap of Abu Ubaidah. And he walked into the house of Abu Ubaidah and he saw nothing. He said, أين متاعك? Where is your furniture? And he said, I don't see but a plate and a rug. That's it. That's the house of Abu Ubaidah. وأنت أمير. He said, you are the Amir. Aren't you the commander? عندك طعام? Do you have any food to feed me? And Abu Ubaidah went and he brought few pieces of bread. That's all he had. And then Umar started crying. And Abu Ubaidah said, didn't I tell you, Umar, that you will weep in my presence? And he said, غَيَّرَتْنَا الدُّنْيَا كُلُّنَا يَا أَبَا عُبَيْدَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. He said, this life, this wealth, this changed all of us except you, يَا أَبَا عُبَيْدَ. You stayed on the right path of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after that, the Raqqa, Hims, and Damascus fell into the Muslim hands, and the area of Al-Jazeera entirely was the last territory in Asham to fall into the Muslims. And now the entire area of Asham, from Ar-Raha, which is this area of what is known today as Cilicia, into Palestine in the south, into Al-Jazeera in the east, into the borders of the Arabian Peninsula in the south, became Muslim territories. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to secure the Muslims in these territories until the Day of Judgment. Ameen. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. اللهم أعد الإسلام إلى دينك ردا جميلا يا رب العالمين وأعد إلينا مقدساتنا ومساجدنا يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين وأعلي يا مولانا كلمتي الحق والدين يا رب العالمين وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Yes. Build the Masjid al-Aqsa as you see it, as the one that we spoke of. Let me show you. If you mean who built the place where Umar prayed, that was Umar. Right. That was the first time. This Masjid al-Sakhra was built by Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan.
Right. Yeah.
By the Umayyad Khalifa.
Right. Right.
Yes.
I heard about the hadith in the Al-Aqsa being built 4 years from Mecca.
document he wasn't, but in other books he was one of the people that actually led the you know, Sophronius. And one of the things that I was talking that I narrated, that Artabun talked to Amr ibn al-As, but Sophronius sent to Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. So his name is mentioned in that particular event, and that was in Ibn Kathir, if I'm not mistaken. He was there. Allahu A'lam. Allah knows best.
Well, he was still the leading commander.
Right. Well, we spoke of that before, right. He would let, like when he was in Al-Urdun, he let Shurahbil lead the army even though he was there, because he was most familiar with the fighting and the territory. So when he goes to Palestine, he let Amr lead the army. Although he's the general commander, he let Amr lead the tactics. When he was up in Asham, he would, in Qunisreen, for example, he let Khalid do whatever Khalid wants, because Khalid was more expert in that particular field. So that was Abu Ubaidah's way of planning. Yeah, that's what I would just say. Umar ibn Khattab did not see battle in either one, whether when he came to the rescue of Hims or when he went to Jerusalem. He did not see battle in that time. And the immediate governor of Al-Qudus was Amr ibn al-As, and we will speak of that later on.
He went to Jerusalem. He didn't have any protection around him. He just went with a servant.
With a small caravan, servant, and a donkey. That's what he did. Yes, subhanAllah, too many hands. Just, jazakumullah khair. I wish somebody, I don't know exactly. Does anybody know what is the dimension of the sanctuary? How big it is?
Big.
Yeah, it's obviously it's very, very big. But, I mean, some especially Western people, they want to make you think that the masjid is this particular area or that particular area. It's this whole entire thing. This is the haram. This is this entire sanctuary. This is all al-masjid al-Aqsa. Not one particular spot. This is called Musalla Umar, and this is called Masjid al-Sakhra, right here. But this whole thing is called al-Masjid al-Aqsa.
This is one-fourth of Jerusalem.
One-fourth of Jerusalem, right.
Where is the fortified Jerusalem
walls? That I really don't know, but it's outside the sanctuary. I mean, I don't have a picture of that. Yes, Jazakallah. The rock is right above the rock, okay? And it's built by Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. This entire sanctuary is called Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. Like when you speak of Al-Masjid Al-Haram, you speak of Al-Ka'ba or this entire place around it. And this is the same similitude. Is you speaking of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa is this entire thing. You speak of Al-Musalla, where Umar was, where this today known as Musalla Masjid Al-Aqsa, the prayer place of Masjid Al-Aqsa, it's right here in the front. And if you, and this is where the fire was in this particular place. I think the fire was in 1968,
1969. The first fire that the Jews
pushed. In the
30s,
right.
In the 30s.
And then the 69. But they were targeting this area.
Yes, the second one when they burned the member of Salah al-Din al-Ayyubi, that was in the... So there's many, for over the years, they always try to burn that area.
Just one thing, one last thing before we inshallah close, is that Al-Aqsa, they think of As-Sakhra, but it's not. It is absolutely not. This is just one portion. I mean, it's like, And لله المثل الأعلى, Allah has the best, you know, like speaking of the green dome and the Masjid al-Nabawi. Is that the Masjid al-Nabawi? No. It's the entire area. And this particular dome is the Dome of the Rock, which is one part of al-Masjid al-Aqsa, which is a huge place. Which is, I mean, as one-fourth of old Jerusalem. This is the Masjid al-Aqsa. This whole entire rectangle. Al-Masjid al-Aqsa. The current Musalla, the place of Salah. Now, this is not the entire place. You see, there are trees, and this is all part of the Masjid al-Aqsa. And inshallah, one day will be built. But this built, this Musalla, is the what is known today as Musalla Masjid al-Aqsa. It's the place of prayer in al-Masjid al-Aqsa.
And there's a mosque there.
Pardon me?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. This, you see this dome? This is a small dome right there. Just one more thing, let me please, and inshallah we may have more discussion later on. The final scene of the conquest of Asham was the Heraclius. Heraclius had a prophecy when he was in Sham, and he said that if he talked to Abu Sufyan, and he said, if you, what you are telling me about Muhammad in a long story, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that if you tell me, what you're telling me about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is true, then he will own what's under my feet. He will own this place. And it happened. Qaisar, Herakl, used to make pilgrimage to Jerusalem, to visit the church of Jerusalem every single year. And every year he will go back to Al-Qastantiniyya, to Constantinople. And every time he would look, he would stay up in the area of Ar-Raha. And this is where he, this is mountainous area in the north. And he would see Syria. He would see Asham in front of him. And he would, every time he would say, عليك السلام يا سوريا. And Syria is actually a name that the Byzantine called Asham. And he would call it Syria. He said, you get my greeting, Syria. تسليما مودع لم يقض منك وطرا وهو عائد. That a greeting of somebody who's leaving you and not satisfied with you, and he's coming back. And this is what he would say to Syria every day until he got this year into Ar-Raha, and he looked at Syria and he said, عليك السلام يا سوريا سلاما لا لقاء بعده. He said, salam, greeting to you, Syria, a greeting we will not see each other again. He knows that the Muslims, this is not temporary. This is coming to stay, as he knew that what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the right prophet from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this religion will conquer and will stay in that place. And he looked at a prisoner of war and he said, tell me about those soldiers that are fighting us. And the prisoner looked at Qaisar and said, هم فرسان النهار ورهبان الليل. He said, they are the horsemen in the daytime, and they are the monks at night. They are the worshipper at night. مَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي ذِمَّتِهِمْ إِلَّا بِثَمَنٍ. He said, they don't steal. They're honest. وَلَا يَدْخُلُونَ إِلَّا بِسَلَامٍ. They do not break in. They always come in peace and permission. And he said, يَقْدُونَ عَلَى مَنْ حَارَبُوهُ حَتَّى يَأْتُوا عَلَيْهِ. He said, they continue fighting their enemies until they are victorious. And then again in Ar-Raha said, he said, لَإِن صَدَقْتَنِي لَيَمْلِكُونَ مَوْضِعَ قَدَمَيْ هَاتَيْنِ. He said, if you are true, then they will again own what's under my feet there. And he was in northern Syria. And of course, only a few years later, Muslims owned most of minor Asia and the most of the areas of the Byzantine. And later on, Muslims went into Constantinople itself, led by Muhammad al-Fatih, al-Khalifa al-Uthmani, and the Muslims, they were the reason that the Byzantine Empire was no more.
It was the same Iraq who fought the Muslim army? It was the same Iraq?
The same one. The very same one from the day of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the same one that was defeated by the Muslims in the Futuh al-Sham. Inshallah wa ta'ala, we will stop here for al-Isha, and next session, inshallah, we will speak of Futuh Misr, Egypt, and Libya. Inshallah, what happened on the day of Umar ibn al-Khattab. And I apologize for those who did not get the chance to comment or ask their questions. And inshallah, we'll start with Adhan al-Isha. Jazakumullah khair.